For a long time, pretty much everyone has used the QWERTY keyboard layout, but as time goes on, more and more people are discovering and using other keyboard layouts. Usually, that layout is either COLMAC or Dvorak. However, if you've ever looked deeper into the world of keyboard layouts, you may have discovered that there are hundreds. Many of these keyboard layouts are generally considered better than COLMAC and Dvorak, but how do you even know if one layout is better than another one, and how could you design your own keyboard layout? Just like anything else, keyboard layouts need to be designed with a purpose in mind. Usually, the purpose of a layout is to let people type as comfortably and efficiently as possible. But more specifically, you need to consider that every person types different things, and every person types in a different way. Usually, when we consider what things people type with our layout, we build a large corpus of text that accurately reflects the language we type in. You could design a layout for multiple languages or based solely off of Discord messages, but these are less common. Using the corpus we choose, we can find the most common patterns of characters, and later on, we can prioritize those when we design our layout. How we design our layout will also be affected by the way that the people using it type. The main question is, which keys do they press with which fingers? This might seem a lot more complicated than finding a corpus, since there are seemingly infinite ways that people could type on a keyboard, and there's no obvious way to average them, but there is a really simple solution. The home row method is usually considered the best way to type, since you're making use of all of your fingers and you don't waste time looking down and searching for the keys. So the almost universal philosophy of the community is that if you care enough to learn a keyboard layout at all, you should learn good typing form as well. And so when we design layouts, we usually just assume the person will be using the standard home row method. Now that we have a sense of what we want our layout to achieve, we can actually start placing letters. There are a lot of different statistics and techniques you could consider during this process, but I'll introduce some of the more common ones that are almost always used. One of the most foundational ideas when it comes to designing a keyboard layout is minimizing the average travel distance of each finger. Generally speaking, the less your fingers have to move, the more comfortable and fast it is to type on your layout. Imagine your fingers are resting on the 8 home row keys. If you look at how far each key is from the closest finger, it's clear that some keys are easier to press than others. And just like the keys, not all letters are created equal either. It's a natural feature of language that some letters are much more common than others. And if you figure out how often each letter appears in your corpus, you can use that to map the most common letters to the easiest to reach keys, making your layout much more efficient. But let's take a step back. Distance from the home row isn't the only thing that affects how it feels to press a key. We consider the distance between a key and its nearest home row finger, but that ignores the fact that not all of our fingers are the same. Generally, our index fingers have the most dexterity, followed by our middle fingers, then ring, then pinky. So we should reflect that in our design. Now we have a much more specific ranking of which keys are the easiest to press. And one more thing, the index fingers are unique in that they have to make these weird lateral movements to press some keys, and many people find those especially uncomfortable, so we could probably account for that too. Those are probably the most important things to consider, but if you really wanted, you might decide that typing with your right hand is slightly more comfortable than the left. Or you could individually give every key a score based on how you personally feel. But those assumptions should be used with caution, because they depend on the person. Now everything that I just talked about can be done relatively manually, but it's also important to know that we often use programs called layout analyzers to do a lot of the heavy lifting for us. Because even if you don't know a lot about designing keyboard layouts, it's really easy to set some parameters and have a computer generate and compare thousands of layouts for you. Even when layouts are designed completely by hand, layout analyzers can give you statistics to work with, and they let you compare your layout to others. But still, layout analyzers have their limits, and their output depends completely on the parameters set by you and the person who made them, so they're more of a tool than anything else. One very important part of layout design, which can be seen by computers more easily than humans, is SFB percentage. SFBs, or same finger bigrams, are pairs of letters that are typed with the same finger. On QWERTY, there are a lot of common examples. And if you give any of them a try, you can tell that typing an SFB is pretty uncomfortable and slow. And so it's important to make SFBs as infrequent as possible. Now, in my mind, SFBs are like the main thing that makes keyboard layout design difficult. If you don't consider them at all, then your layout won't be good no matter how much you optimize for travel distance. But if you do consider them, then that means every key swap has a lot of ripple effects that are hard to see. SFB percentage is one of the main things we consider when we compare keyboard layouts. And just to give some perspective, if we use every quote on MonkeyType and TypeRacer combined as our corpus, then QWERTY has an SFB percentage of 5.25%, Colmac has 1.4%, and this modern layout, Recurva, has only 0.72%. Now, SFB percentage can change a lot depending on the corpus, and there are a lot of other statistics you need to consider as well, but this still goes to show that modern layouts that most people have never heard of are actually a lot better than Dvorak and Colmac. So to summarize, if you optimize travel distance, key weighting, and SFBs, and you do that relative to your chosen corpus and typing method, then you can make a really good keyboard layout. So I hope that this brief introduction to how keyboard layouts are designed was interesting, and I hope it inspired you to go learn more. I want to emphasize that this video really just scratches the surface. There are a lot of things that did not make it in this video, so if you do want to know more, make sure you check out the Alt Keyboard Layouts Discord, because that is where everything I know about keyboard layouts came from. Thanks for watching.